Well, welcome everybody. It's great to have you here. Congratulations to the class of 2020. I'm going to give a special welcome to our parents and our grandparents, siblings and friends and former Poly students who joined us today, and a special welcome to our Board of Trustees. I also want to welcome all of you who've come from literally around the world to watch tonight's festivities. I'd like to begin with a moment of silence. A moment of silence for those whom we wish dearly could share this momentous day with us. A moment of silence for those, for the more than 100,000 people who have died from the coronavirus. And a moment of silence for our communities suffering from the impact of racism and violence. The arrival of the graduation tent has always given me a much-needed boost during the last week of school. For every class, no matter the highs and lows, the year would come to a fitting conclusion under a magnificent circus-like tent here on Babcock Field. Over 1,000 members of the extended Poly community would tuck themselves carefully into labeled seats, mostly numbered and assigned to families of our graduates. Our own Chris Halstead would pipe the faculty and seniors from the back, letting the sound of the bagpipes that burrow into our souls cut through the crowd, marking the ceremony's beginning. This year's ceremony is different, markedly so. The tent we raised on the field today is small, just big enough to shade a few of us and your diplomas. There was no crowd. Instead, each of you in your car wound your way from the Garland parking lot onto the field in a carefully choreographed parade reminiscent of Noah's Ark, 2x2. I cannot imagine what it feels like to watch this pre-recorded ceremony while scattered throughout Pasadena and the surrounding communities. What I do know is that graduations are never really about how impressive the tent is or how many people cheer you on. Instead, they're meant to serve as a reminder to you and to all of us what you have become. Don't get me wrong, all of us coming together for celebrations like this is important, and vitally so. And when we bring you all together again next June, the tent will struggle to hold the festivities. But for now, a bit of shade, an historic parade, and a virtual celebration will mark this year's graduation. Today has brought the end to your years at Poly, for some 13, of hard work, bumps and bruises, friendships discovered, and relationships cemented with people who will stand you for a lifetime. One of the advantages I've had in the past was my view looking over the rows of guests, looking at your teachers who inspired you, your families and raised you, and your friends who also raised you. Wherever they are today, their cheers are no less important, and their pride in you perhaps even greater. You have all been through a lot, and you've had plenty of time to imagine what might have been. We all have. And yet we wouldn't honor the promise of our mission and the legacy of this institution if we let our experiences and the heartbreak from the last 10 weeks dim the celebrations, large and small, that we've participated in. To all the parents, grandparents, siblings, and friends of the class of 2020, today we are graduating a group of young people who will be better prepared for the world than perhaps any class before them in this institution's illustrious history. They have acquired the wisdom from their time to reflect and the resilience that will fuel their efforts to tackle the seemingly intractable problems and dilemmas facing us and them. We are in good hands. Thank you. Now, before I turn things over to our students and Ms. Fleischer, I have two pieces of business. The first, most educational institutions have ceremonies or graduations that mark the culmination of an extraordinary teaching, rigorous learning, and exceptional growth. At Poly, we are no different about what graduation celebrates, and we've added a unique twist to the voices you will hear. When our seniors, 8 of them, chosen randomly from the class, take to the podium, their remarks will eloquently capture what they have learned and what they see ahead. The future, once only a glimmer in their eyes, will shine triumphantly and attainably in front of them and you. Like the very dressed traditions, their words and lessons are timeless, and we have a tapestry that displays the health and vividness of our mission. We say goodbye today by hearing what students have learned to value, to embrace, and to celebrate. The institution will once again be defined and reaffirmed for the generations to follow. My second piece of business is thank yous. Today's ceremony and parade represent an extraordinary amount of thought and care and time from a number of people from our community. Across our campus, the generosity of talent shared to make today possible has been inspiring and humbling. To everyone who helped make these historic festivities possible, thank you.
If you asked 5-year-old me who I'd most like to meet, I would have given you one answer: Judy Garland. Performing Somewhere Over the Rainbow on a little chair while holding a fake stuffed Toto was a daily occurrence in the Rawlinson household. Yes, I was, and still am, a big fan of Judy Garland. Come to think of it, I was really the only 5-year-old boy I knew of who loved Judy Garland and idolized strong women. But why? Maybe it's the fact that my mother has been such a strong female figure for me throughout my life. Maybe it has to do with how I was pushed away by so many boys throughout my earlier years. But I got excluded from my fair share of girl groups too, so I'm not really sure that's the case. But I've always felt a sense of not belonging. Maybe that's why I love Judy as Dorothy so much. She didn't belong. She dreamed of going somewhere over a rainbow. I wanted to do what Judy did. And perform and inspire. My first real time performing was in Polly's first grade production of The Little Red Hen. I felt I was not ready for the ingenue role of the Red Hen yet, but there was another role waiting for me, a chick. And thus, my journey began. Fast forward, middle school happens, yeesh, but eventually, ninth grade creeps its way around and I am presented with an opportunity. A black box musical called the 25th Annual Putnam County Spelling Bee. Wow, was I ecstatic. I was given the chance to do something I loved, express myself to the fullest, and be in a group of people who liked performing as much as I, singing, acting, and dancing for an audience. The same little boy who idolized Judy Garland and sang every day and danced around was still there. I could have gotten derailed when sophomore year showed up and I didn't get cast in any leading roles, but you know, Judy Garland was a woman who struggled endlessly throughout her life. Strict diets, addiction, bad men. Judy was a trooper. That girl fought. And I knew my quote-unquote struggle was nowhere near what she went through. Imagine if I just quit because I missed out on some parts. No sir, that's disrespectful. I just needed to work harder. At last, junior year arrives. The Little Mermaid is the spring show, and I am cast as Scuttle. I gotta act silly, tap dance, and most importantly, drop a split at the end. After one of the shows, I received a hand-drawn card from a Poly kindergartner named Phoenix. Apparently, Scuttle was all she could talk about. Her mother even said she was trying much harder in her own dance classes in hopes of one day being like me. That was the first time it dawned on me that I could serve as positive inspiration for someone in the way that Judy Garland had for me. Now, I'm not saying that I am Judy. She was a legend. But I too can have an impact on people by doing what I love and being myself. The wonderful thing about my experience with Phoenix is that despite all the flaws I see in myself, I could inspire her. Being flawed, unique, passionate, hardworking, and different is inspiring. So now, I'm heading off to New York to continue pursuing my dreams, being myself, working hard, idolizing Judy, but most importantly, being a dreamer, looking for that place over the rainbow.
When I was offered the chance to give this speech, I was advised to try and find something about myself that I found special or interesting. I sat with that idea for days, thinking of something that I might want to say. But I am just one of the 96 of you who have accomplished so much in the last 4 years. My thoughts then turned to the mentors who have been responsible for shaping our class into who we are today. And so my message to you is going to be about one of those mentors. Each of us at Poly has somebody who we look to for guidance. For me, that person has always been Miss Williams. But before I share with you the influence that Miss Williams, one of my greatest supporters, has had on my life personally, I want to state at the outset of my speech that this is also for all of the other faculty and staff who have taken time outside of the classroom to help us when times are tough. Now, I could just about fill a book with all that Miss Williams has done for me personally over the years. She seems to have a sixth sense about when to call and check up on me. Her door is always open for a drop-in talk or even an offering of my favorite cookies. She knows how to bolster my self-confidence by trusting me to help solve problems. She was there for me for some of my fondest memories of high school, whether that be helping plan school dances or class events, maybe even running Fun Food Fridays. But she was also there to help me through some of my least fond memories of high school. I remember having an experience with a faculty member that, while I won't get into specifics, left me feeling personally attacked, totally dismissed, and utterly stunned. But the first person I talked to about that incident was Miss Williams. She insisted that I come to her office the very next morning so that she could listen to what I had to say. And she did. She listened to me and offered me guidance, and then eventually helped to facilitate the mending of the relationship I had felt that had been permanently severed. She made me feel comfortable to share my feelings openly and free from judgment. But that's just the kind of person that she is. She's a problem solver at heart who leads by example. She is kind and giving in her time. She listens and encourages and is positive in her support. She's always there for you, just like she has always been there for me. She makes me feel good about who I am and what I can accomplish. Miss Williams, because of your work, you can always know that you have made a life-changing difference on at least one member of this community. But I hope you know that I am in no way alone in how I feel. We will all lead our lives valuing the meaning and the power of human connections, remembering always those like Miss Williams who taught by example and shared with us their time and their humanity. I know that I am a stronger, more passionate, more caring, more thoughtful person because of you, and for that I will be forever grateful. I could not imagine my time at Poly without Miss Williams at the helm, and I certainly wouldn't have wanted it any other way. You have made our time here fun, engaging, and full of joy. So on behalf of my entire class, I would like to say thank you.
Life is often unexpected. We all know how difficult it can be growing into our young adult selves. During my time at Poly, I experienced events that were new and alarming. I lost loved ones. I felt depression and anxiety, which I thought wasn't real. I stumbled upon the bizarre ways that my brain worked, and I learned to love in ways that I didn't know were possible. All of these things happened during my 4 years at Poly. I struggled with both my mental and physical health. I often disregarded my feelings and was consistently afraid to ask for guidance or help. Fortunately, during my sophomore year, amazing teachers like Miss Marion and Mr. Frankie saw my struggles and urged me to take their help. At first, it was hard to accept their assistance. I didn't want what felt like special treatment because I thought it would place me as an outsider. But I realize now I was given the best support I could have asked for, even when I felt like I didn't deserve it. As most of my classmates know, I had quite the extensive number of absences, especially in the 10th grade. But despite being gone for so many days, my teachers provided me with many opportunities to continue my work and studies so that I would not fall behind. My junior year was not much better, and after missing so many classes, I faced the possibility of not being able to graduate. And because of that, I met with a teacher at least once a day. Although it felt embarrassing to ask for help, I knew it was the only way I would be able to catch up. Even though there are a lot of extremely difficult moments, I was shown kindness and compassion in my journey through the upper school. When I was fearful of others seeing me cry, I found that I was embraced by so many teachers and friends. Even though I don't remember all the times that I cried, I remember the comfort and safety I felt with the people who surrounded me. And I am forever grateful for that support. When I was having a long day, I knew I could go to Senora Levine's office to sit in her bungee chairs or to receive a warm embrace. When I needed a break from my studies, no matter how busy she was, Miss Williams was always welcoming with candy and conversations about dogs. When I was upset and didn't think anyone would notice, Ms. Zetlian would be sure to check in with me and pray with me. When I felt lost in moments, I knew I could speak to Ms. Stebbins about her wonderful talents, including knitting. And no matter how difficult my day was, I knew I could go into the math offices and draw pigs on the whiteboards and have an entertaining conversation with Dr. Nguyen and Mr. Ordonez, even if they thought that I was just bugging them. Throughout the year, I grew more comfortable talking to the adults at Poly about the difficulties in my life. And it was through these hard times that I learned that asking for help is okay. Everyone needs help, and no one should be afraid to ask for it. At Poly, I learned that asking for help is a strength that is needed in life. Had I not grown more trusting of others, I would have never discovered the amazing outcomes that could happen if I just asked for help. I'm so fortunate to say that with the encouragement from the Poly community, I am now able to stand here in front of all of you. As Elle Woods would say, we did it.
Hello, everyone. In the last few years, I have observed an increasing emphasis on dialogue, discussion, discourse, debate, both at Poly and outside of it. And I think that's a good thing. But we do not consider often enough why engaging with others' views is so valuable. Engaging in dialogue is important because doing so can and should inform our ethical frameworks. I think it is imperative that all of us ask ourselves what a just society might look like. In order to do this, we must first work to empathize with and understand others, because one cannot begin to theorize about what a just society would look like for other people before also understanding what today's society, what the status quo, is like for others. One of the most important experiences I've had with regard to participating in dialogue with or observance of other perspectives was in reading Between the World and Me by Ta-Nehisi Coates the summer before ninth grade. In the form of a letter to his son, Coates describes how he moves through and operates within the United States, the fear he feels for his son's life, and, more broadly, the existential physical threat the state poses to black folks. This book reframed how I thought about the history of this country, forced me to reconsider the relationship between citizens and the state, and, perhaps more than anything else, made clear the stark differences between my experiences and Coates's, between how my father talked to me and how Coates addresses his son. I was already concerned about inequality and injustice, but it wasn't until reading Coates's letter to his son that I recognized the gravity of these issues. I was grateful then that it was assigned in my 11th grade English class and that I had the opportunity to discuss both the text and its implications with my classmates. Though I don't think empathy can be taught to or forced upon people, I hope that my fellow white peers would have a similar shift in perspective if they had not already. I urge Poly to work to center more black authors in reading lists, black scholars in our curricula, and black voices in our conversations. Following the murder of George Floyd by police officers in Minneapolis, Minnesota, I have thought more about the matters discussed in Coates' letter. Indeed, my occasional, situational, hypothetical consideration of state-sponsored violence, as opposed to the personal fear of experiencing it myself, is a function of my position as a white person and something I must acknowledge. Protests against police brutality have taken place in every state across the country. In many cities, these demonstrations have escalated into violence and rioting, almost exclusively after instigation and unnecessary violence by police, not by organizers themselves. In response, some have criticized the strategies or behaviors of black protesters. After reading texts like Between the World and Me, after coming to realize how little my experience resembled that of the vast majority of folks across the country, I understood that there must be an admission that white people do not have all the answers, particularly with respect to what methods of protest are legitimate, and that we must not criticize the reaction to racial violence, but the violence itself. I don't think I could have arrived at this understanding without reading authors like Coates and without accepting the limits of my perspective. This awareness also cannot happen for others without access to and willingness to engage with viewpoints that diverge from their own. This is why we must continue to read, watch, and listen to voices that we might not encounter without deliberate intent, and why we need to push for the reading of black authors in whatever academic spaces we occupy in the coming years. Thank you.
When I think of the Polytechnic School, I don't necessarily think of positive things. If I'm being honest, the past 7 years have been excruciating at times. For my first 5 years, I never really felt like I fit in. I came into Bali as an awkward, dorky kid. And I mean, for those of us who can recall my middle school days, you might remember my two-toned Ray-Bans with purple and orange. I feel like wearing two-toned glasses really says something about a person. You either have the world's highest self-confidence or zero self-awareness. For me, it was the latter. I came into Poly with no awareness as to what was trendy or how I was supposed to act. But I soon realized that the weird public magnet school I came from, where kids were just as awkward and wacky as I was nothing like what Poly was gonna be. I'm not really sure Poly was ready for me, or maybe I wasn't ready for Poly, but it was a hard first 2 years. By the third year, I had found my place, but I had lost my spunk. By the end of sophomore year, I began to realize I had lost what made me the kid I was in sixth grade. The willingness to embarrass myself, to mess up, to fail, the willingness to be unapologetically me. This was the lowest point in my educational career. I think everyone experiences similar discomfort, the kind of thing that makes you want to run from a room crying and never stop running, and I never, ever like to run, ever. But to make that discomfort go away, you have to see yourself. And I'm not saying you have to be overly confident or get over what people think of you, but because I think that's impossible. At least for me it is. I will always care to some degree what people think of me, but as sophomore summer progressed, I began to see myself in ways that I hadn't since sixth grade. I began to see my value, my worth, my voice's validity. And honestly, Poly helped me realize that. My peers helped me realize that. I'd been put in the corner time and time again to the point where I began to feel sorry for myself. But soon I realized I could either sink or swim. And if you don't swim, you drown. And I sure as hell wasn't going to let myself drown. This school showed me that hard work pays off, that putting hours upon hours into my work, my art, and myself would allow me to succeed in ways I wanted to. And looking back, it might have pushed me in ways I might have considered bad, but I don't think that's fair, because there's no bad in being broken just enough that you have to get up stronger than before. I have to admit there were times that I got a little too close to the bottom, but there were always people there to help me back up. But the journey to realizing that you're worth your own time is one that has to be done on your own. And if you haven't reached that point yet, I don't think I've fully reached that point yet. That's okay, because you have 8 more, 12 more, 45 more, 70 more years of learning ahead of you. Learning about where you fit into the world. And if you don't, sorry, when you don't, learning how to carve your own mold, how to take up your own space, and how to shape it to the way you want it to be. Because you deserve every inch of that space. So go, take that space, and never let go of it. No matter what people think, never apologize for being you.
During my senior exit interview, I was asked, "What would you tell your younger self?" I immediately thought back to my sophomore year, which was the point in my life when I definitely needed all of the guidance I could get. At the time, I thought everyone around me was either thriving socially or academically, yet those areas of my life were greatly lacking. Even though I appeared put together, I still felt like an outsider in the very community I had joined in middle school. Eventually, my prolonged feelings of alienation forced me to either seek out comforting spaces on campus or to create my own. At the start of my junior year, I pushed myself to be more open-minded about the people in my grade and to try new things. And I grew a lot. I made more meaningful friendships than ever before, discovered groups like the Asian American Alliance and Sexual Health and Education Nicaragua, and learned that I really loved diversity, equity, and inclusion work. I had more open and honest discussions with my peers about being Asian American, talked to the administration about the mental health stigma on campus, and led advisory shakeups on these topics to share with the broader community. Although my self-exploration and subsequent activism benefited me in many ways, I also became more aware of the parts of myself that still separated me from the rest of my peers, like my Taiwanese American heritage or my Buddhist religion. While I was more self-assured, I was still searching for acceptance and understanding on a deeper level. As I entered my senior year, I was hopeful that I would finally find that sense of belonging by the time I graduated. I pictured stepping onto campus on my last day at Poly, eager that all would go smoothly. I pictured myself in my final class of the day, admiring my classmates, yet regretful that I never got to know some of them as well as I had wanted. I pictured myself marveling at our disheveled yet homely senior patio with the tightness in my chest that would only be magnified by my realization that I had taken so many parts of Poly for granted, like our campus whose beauty rivals that of a college. And when it would finally be time for me to depart, I would know that although I was leaving the physical space of Poly behind, I was carrying the people, memories, and lessons from it into the next chapter of my life. And I would finally feel like an insider. Because we haven't stepped onto campus since Friday, March 13th, I will never know if that idealistic goodbye would have happened. Although I never got to feel like a complete insider at Poly in the way that I had hoped for in my sophomore and junior years, I still appreciate what I learned from the perspective of an outsider. That's what I tell my younger self. So much good can come from feeling isolated, and there are many people around you who feel the same way because we all have facets of our identities that differentiate us from others. For me, it's my race. For others, it might be their socioeconomic background, their political ideology, their learning difference, or their sexual orientation. Because of our differences, we are a collective community of outsiders. This realization is an invaluable lesson. It pushes us to explore our identities and to connect more meaningfully with the people around us. And somewhere down the line, when inevitably I will feel like an outsider again, I will think back to my lessons learned at Poly and be excited about the future parts of myself that I will discover, the people that I will connect with, and the community that I will find. Thank you.
My first day as a student on Poly's campus, I tripped and fell flat on my face. Not a sweet little stumble, but a full-blown backpack over my head barely saved my face kind of fall. I was new in my freshman year, walking to Studio Art, my second class of the day, and of course I had to make a huge scene by faceplanting on the senior patio. Grossly tattered knobby knees, a scuff mark on my brand new, obscenely white Vans, and tears forming in the corners of my eyes, I did not know anyone at Poly yet, so I was forced to pick myself up, dust myself off, and pretend like it had never happened. As I choked back sobs, more so out of embarrassment than pain, I realized I could not show up to my second class of the day, completely disheveled with a puffy red face. Eventually, I worked up the courage to leave the safety of the bathroom and go to class, when all of a sudden, I bumped into the only person I really knew on campus, Kylie Kishi. It turns out she was also in studio art. Neither of us had ever taken an art class, so we were nervous and intimidated to say the least. But we fumbled our way around the art-making process and along the way discovered our friendship. Kylie and I talked for the entirety of every class, both when we were allowed to and sometimes when we weren't. We seldom completed our work on time, and we never created any pieces with the accuracy and precision we had hoped for. But nevertheless, we fell in love with our time painting and drawing and talking in the studio art room with Mr. Bielvet. As I reflect back on my past 4 years in the Poly Upper School, so many instances like this one come to mind. Poly has always been a place where I threw myself into situations, tripped and stumbled my way along, and came out on the other side, certainly with more bruises, but usually with more confidence too. Before I came to Poly, I thought that the only way to pursue your passion or find your path was by devoting yourself to a single craft and working tirelessly until your hard work paid off and you became a master at it. This has not been the case for me. I've never had a miraculous epiphany or a serendipitous discovery of an all-consuming talent. I tripped and fell and face-planted to find the things and the people I enjoy. It wasn't until I dissected the situation years later that I realized that the first fall at Poly might have quite literally left scars on my knees, but this place has made a much larger, more symbolic mark on who I am as a person. I realized how much I had fallen in love with Poly's campus, its trees, its values. I realized how much I was going to miss my teachers and my classmates, how much I would miss eating lunch on that very spot where I had face-planted freshman year. Poly and the people here taught me that falling into your fears and finding what you like by struggling for it is okay. Sometimes the fall is big and ugly, sometimes you scrape your knees, dirty your white Vans, and tears fill your eyes, but I would never trade the painful scrapes and scratches for anything. So while we might never get to say goodbye to our beloved school, I am standing here before you today to say thank you. Thank you for the Band-Aids that covered what felt like gigantic gashes made by bad grades. Thank you for giving me ice packs for the bruises to my ego when I made a fool of myself. Thank you for the helping hands that picked me back up when I stumbled over my own feet. But most importantly, thank you to Pauly for teaching me that falling isn't failing.
One of Nelson Mandela's most prominent quotes states, "Education is the most powerful weapon which you can use to change the world." Pauly has provided us with a high level of education, but I feel it important to share some thoughts before we all go off to our respective colleges. Trust your intuition and start getting comfortable with being uncomfortable. Take that course that looks interesting, talk to that person you typically ignore, and let your voice be heard. The ability to intelligently dialogue and critique the thinking of others is paramount to the educational process. In an attempt to be politically correct, some of us have been reluctant or unable to articulate how we truly feel. During my sophomore year, I ran an advisory shakeup, an hour-long student-led discussion that discussed minority experiences on campus. During the shakeup, hardly anyone talked, and for a moment, I struggled to recognize why this was the case. Now, I understand that it was a hard ask for my peers to talk about a topic that didn't directly affect some of them. But I have also recognized that when it feels most difficult to talk, your voice is most important. In the words of Mahatma Gandhi, many people, especially ignorant people, want to punish you for speaking the truth, for being correct, for being you. Never apologize for being correct, or for being years ahead of your time. If you're right, and you know it, speak your mind. Speak your mind. Even if you're a minority of one, the truth is still the truth. Now the time has come for us to enter a world outside of Pauly, and I know firsthand that that world won't always be fair. I hope that Pauly will do a better job of addressing issues of disagreements and differences. I believe that suppressing our differences has the potential to be detrimental to how we interact with those in and outside of the Pauly community. If we are truly to come together as a community, ignoring our differences won't get us there. Make no mistake about it, I love Pauly for all it has done to prepare me for my life's next journey, and most importantly, for forever connecting me with all of the beautiful people I'm addressing today. We're all brilliant young minds with the potential to do great things in this world, so don't let anything or anyone hold you back. Remember, you have the most powerful weapon which you can use to change the world. Use it.
Good evening, and welcome, graduates, parents, siblings, faculty, and friends. In a few moments, you will get to see each of our graduates in their commencement attire. Together, they make up an extraordinary class, and I would like to take a few moments to share with you why, during these troubling times, they should help you worry a little less. There's so much to fret about right now. Racism, police brutality, divisive politics, climate change, economic uncertainty, a dramatic rise in major mental health issues, and of course, we are literally in the middle of a global pandemic with an unknown timeline and toll. I'm getting more stressed just sharing this list with all of you. Then, I reflect on this group of young people, the class of 2020, and I can take a deep breath. You already know what I mean, both about our times and about these graduates. You've likely heard the descriptor, born in the wake of 9/11 and graduating in a global pandemic. These are complex, immediate, overarching blockades. What does history tell us that this kind of challenge brings? It motivates invention, creativity, kindness in spades, and hope. I trust we can all agree that our world needs each of those traits in greater quantities than we've seen in any of our lifetimes. You've heard repeatedly throughout this celebration season what graduates around the world, and this class in particular, have lost. As our springtime isolation has dragged on, many in-person events have become virtual, and others have slipped away entirely, making those of us who have seen these cycles roll through differently shrug our shoulders in frustration, sigh wistfully, and trudge on. You need to know, though, that there is another remarkable face to this tale that truly affirms my faith in a brighter future. Whether out of self-preservation, a sense of moral responsibility, or maybe even sheer stubbornness, the class of 2020 has changed the face of their senior spring in so many ways. I trust we as a community and the students who come after them will be following in their footsteps and holding on to the new traditions they've established. Everything has been turned on its head this year. It's not uncommon for all members of a school like Pauly to be exhausted as we approach the end of the year, yearning for the long days of summer and desperately trying to keep our seniors connected, engaged, safe, making mostly good decisions are the hallmark of a typical 100 days of May. This year, we find ourselves praying for the safety and health of all of our community members, working to stay connected with all of our students via one more video conference, and wanting time to slow down so we can return to be together. But our worries of seniors fulfilling responsibilities, staying engaged, making mostly good decisions, these have all proved not to be a concern this year. The members of the class of 2020 have been models of community building and strength. Acorns to Oak Trees is an annual tradition where our seniors spend a day working with lower school students and their teachers in their classrooms. Ordinarily, they devote a single morning and are working in small pods within a lower school classroom. This year, across 2 weeks and 34 different Zooms, our seniors showed up for our lower school students. As I got to be a fly on the wall in quite a few, you too would have hope for our future if you saw what I saw. Bright-eyed, precocious, and adorable young people whose faces lit up in awe and inspiration as they talked to, interviewed, and connected with our seniors. Our seniors weren't merely humoring the 6, 7, 8-year-old version of themselves. In sharing pieces of their lives, they were uplifting everyone around them and also clearly enjoying the experience. As I bounced around from virtual room to room, I couldn't help smiling and feeling the early rumblings of the now established faith and contentment that settle in my heart as we send this group off. Our graduates are selfless teachers. A new feature of our reimagined senior weeks, one that we will have to figure out how to maintain, is the way that our seniors share their passions and skills with their classmates. From cooking spaghetti carbonara and baking chocolate lava cake, to oil painting, dancing, and even playing video games, this group stepped up and opened their pastimes to any of their peers who wanted to join in and helped others improve. Our graduates have ingenuity, drive, and commitment. For the past few years, seniors have had the option to take on an independent, non-curricular project. We've only had a few pursue these, but this year, even before we went out for quarantine, we had more approved projects than we have yet seen. Not surprisingly, they all required connection, facilities, and access to the outside world. They were all given the nod in early March. Before any of them could get their feet off the ground, the foundation crumbled. Had the energy and enthusiasm dissipated along with the rest of our normalcy, no one would have faulted them. And yet, it didn't. Instead, we saw workarounds, tweaks, even 180-degree turns. Producing a variety show, exploring and sharing Los Angeles, creating a pop-up diner, starting a clothing design company, all on the docket, and none could proceed as originally intended. Instead, they saw an opportunity in being safer at home. From creating friendship bracelets and personalized notes to meal kits, through the virtual and artistic rendering of exploring Los Angeles, and a dichotomous key of trees at Poly without ever leaving their home, these seniors dug in, learned a ton, and shared even more. When this group presented their culminations, certainly I marveled at what they had accomplished, but I also relished in the rapt attention their classmates, parents, and teachers gave them as they exuded their optimism, solutions-oriented approaches, and passion for their community, heartened by just how many of us showed up to see and support their work. Our graduates have grit and perspective. These are easy times to be feeling sorry for yourself, and I'm sure I'm not alone in admitting the hours I've wasted missing my family and friends, frustrated by my ineptitude in navigating a sometimes exclusively virtual world, and just paralyzed by what I've come to call the overwhelm. As we think about what and how we do what we've always done and do it well. And yet, I invite you to look to this group. They still produce 2 more student newspapers, a yearbook, gave back to their community, wrote old school letters to their friends, reached out with ideas and offers to help, and found gratitude in all that they still had. They had fun. They danced and played at the prom preview. They set up open video game meetups. They mocked the alternative options and yet still showed up and brought it to life, brought to life age-old spring Poly traditions. I believe they did it not for themselves, really, but for you, their parents, their faculty, their younger classmates, and because only they could. They made it impossible to spend our time feeling sorry for them because they made the best of it all. They stayed engaged and connected, and they saved all of us. We're all sitting here watching yet another screen and buying in because of their extraordinary generosity. To be clear, we are living in a momentous time with serious and seemingly intractable issues. Issues which we all have responsibility to dig in and work to ameliorate. Neither the sole responsibility nor the panacea lies with our seniors, but I believe they are very much a part of the path to a healthier and more just world, and I am grateful that they are heading out into it when we need their help the most. This group already has their diplomas in hand, which thankfully they actually got to pick up in person. It is now time to share this group with you. I humbly present the inspiring graduates of the class of 2020. Congratulations and thank you.
Like hell,
and I guess you.